Firstly, a note on the screen. Our apologies if it's a bit wonky. We've had a few problems with it this morning and it's as best as we can get it. So apologies. But mainly a very warm welcome to St. Peter's Church this morning. Whether you're joining us in church or whether you're catching up with us later in the week, we do hope you will find in this service a moment to step aside from everyday life, to experience God's presence, to know his peace, to allow him to break into our busy lives with a word of encouragement, a gentle nudge, or even a challenge, and to leave here refreshed and ready to face the week, whatever that week might bring. So as we open our service, I'd like to say a prayer based on the psalm for today, which is Psalm 23. And I think you'll possibly hear the echoes of Psalm 23 throughout this service. Let's pray. Generous God and giver of all things, we rest in your loving and tender care, and we are revived, restored, and renewed by your strength and encouragement. You go before us in life, leading us in pathways that are secure without the confusion of becoming lost, aware only that we always need to follow you, and so we trust in your guidance and wisdom. As human beings, we know there will be times of stress, when our body or mind lets us down. We know there will be dark times too, when life seems to be nothing but struggle. And it is in those times especially that we rely on your presence deep within us to guide and bless us. Grace-giving God, you provide us with the tools we need for the tasks we face, and for this we give you our trust and thanks. Life-giving God, you put out the welcome mat for us as we gather to worship you. You nourish our souls and bodies through your goodness and tender mercies. You heal our life's wounds, and your generous love fills us to overflowing. You give us an honored place at your table and invite us to stay with you as your guest forever. You have promised that your unfailing love will stay with us always, and for this we give you our thanks. Amen. Our first song is The Lord's My Shepherd.
To love in past,
We say together the prayer of confession. God of healing, God of wholeness, we bring our brokenness, our sinfulness, our fears and despair, and lay them at your feet. God of healing, God of wholeness, we hold out hearts and hands, minds and souls, to feel your touch and know the peace that only you can bring. God of healing, God of wholeness, this precious moment in your presence and power, grant us faith and confidence that here broken lives are made whole. Amen. We also say together the collect for the day. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion. Nourish us with all goodness, and of your great mercy, keep us in the same. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is a version of Psalm 23 by Toki Miyashina. The Lord is my pace setter. I shall not rush. He makes me stop and rest for quiet intervals. He provides me with images of stillness, which restore my serenity. He leads me in ways of efficiency through calmness of mind, and his guidance is peace. Even though I have a great many things to accomplish each day, I will not fret, for his presence is here. His timelessness, his all-importance, will keep me in balance. He prepares refreshment and renewal in the midst of my activity by anointing my head with oils of tranquility. My cup of joyous energy overflows. Surely harmony and effectiveness shall be the fruit of my hours, for I shall walk in the pace of my Lord and dwell in his house forever. This is the word of the Lord. Our gospel reading is from Mark chapter 6, verses 30 to 34, then continuing at verses 53. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, "Come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest." So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. When they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret and anchored there. As soon as they got out of the boat, people recognized Jesus. They ran throughout that whole region and carried the sick on mats to wherever they heard he was. And wherever he went, into villages, towns, or countryside, they placed the sick in the marketplaces. They begged him to let them touch even the edge of his cloak, and all who touched it were healed. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Amen.
Grandeur and earth is great before. The sound of his voice, the seas that are shaken and stirred, and the calm broken for my through it all, my eyes are through it all, it is what. Through it all, my eyes are open. It is well with me. Far be it from me to not believe. Even when my eyes can't see, and this mountain that's in front of me will be thrown into the midst of the sea. Through it all, my eyes are. Through it all, it is well. Through it all, my eyes are. It is well, so let it go, my soul, and trust in Him. The way to win, still know His name. It is well. Through it all, it is well. Through it all.
May these words be worthy of our Father's house. May I speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good morning. And it is good morning. The last Sunday before the COVID restrictions are lifted. Last Sunday, Rita told us about a song that she had held in her heart for over 50 years. And we joined her and Bethany in the actions of the Zacchaeus song. And wasn't that fun? A little taster for next week, when we can all sing again. What a great joy that will be. Alleluia. We have all been captives to COVID. At times it has felt like being under house arrest. Where was God in all of this? The love of God shone through in the support from neighbours and workers, some we knew, but many we had never seen before. So many people loving their neighbours asked themselves. So many people like Jesus and his disciples this morning, working, going extra miles, working, going extra hours, missing meal breaks. So many going that extra mile to heal the sick, to bring hope and salvation and miracles of life to many. I'm sure that many of you too here will have played a crucial part in sharing the love of God, his support, his strength for others. With hearts in our windows and rainbows on display, we rang our bells and clapped our hands and banged our pots and pans in a tribute and thanks to them all. And in the darkest moments, the times the writer of Psalm 23 calls the valley of the shadow of death, the Lord was with us. He was with us all the time. As Graham sang this morning, through it all, shepherding us, guiding us, the Good Shepherd, Psalm 23 in action. As the Spirit of God moved over the surface of the earth and created life on earth, so did his creativity spring forth in the minds of scientists as the vaccination for the virus became discovered and produced. We give thanks for his mercy, faithfulness, which lasts forever. The Lord's goodness and love will follow us all the days of our lives, says Psalm 23. The words of that psalm many may hold in their hearts and minds. There may be other songs too that you have like a soundtrack to your lives. Now, we've had various members of our family staying with us for the last 2 weeks. It did seem longer, but there we go. And in one conversation, we told our younger visitors about desert island discs. Does anyone here listen to desert island discs? Right? Thank you. I can see I might have to explain how the program worked, which we did to our visitors who were in their 30s. A radio guest is cast upon a desert island and they may take 8 gramophone records, but only one they may have to save at the end. And it set me wondering, what if Jesus was on desert island discs? What might he choose? Now, his mother, Mary, was a great singer-songwriter. Well, even Bob Dylan couldn't have written the Magnificat. Did she sing that to Jesus? Or maybe she sang Times the Hour Changing. Would the Magnificat be one of his 8 discs? And it set me thinking, when did Jesus sing? There must have been singing at the wedding in Cana. And then perhaps the last song that Jesus sang, Matthew 26, just after the Last Supper, after singing a hymn, they went off to the Mount of Olives. What did he and the disciples sing that night? Well, I did check with some great authorities, and as it didn't sort of fit with what I wanted to say this morning, I'm going to omit what they told me. Well, they had a large songbook, and we are blessed to be able to share in their songs. The Psalms. Was it one of those written by David and others? I said earlier that it has been like under house arrest, but I must tell you that I know nothing about being under house arrest. I've never been that bold to get into that situation. However, there is in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 16, an account of Paul and Silas in jail. And this is what is written. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns of praise to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. What comfort that must have been for the prisoners. And it replicates what we have experienced during the COVID services here at St. Peter's. In our captivity, we could not sing, but our 3 musicians have been our Pauls and Silas. Each week, they have comforted us, brought us joy, moved us to tears, closer to God, and uplifted us. As the hymn writer of Lord of the Years says, cheered us on our way. And next week, we will be singing with you. And I'm sure I speak for many when I say thank you very much, musicians, for your worship through music and song. May the Lord bless you. You have brought us through the darkest days. Some of the Psalms tell of dark days and days of joy. They are part of the wisdom literature of the Bible, and they cover all styles of writing: prayers and praise, remembrance, prophecy, complaints and fears. It has been called a mirror for all the moods of human experience, and it contains the whole music of the hearts of men and women. And I cannot help wondering if Psalm 23 was sung at the Last Supper or by Paul and Silas in that prison. It provides a picture of God, the Good Shepherd. To turn to our gospel reading, there does seem to be a fulfillment of the psalm, because Jesus, having heard of all the work of his disciples, he decides to take them to a quiet place. He even tries to lead them to green pastures for rest. He goes over still waters, but when he lands, a large crowd are waiting. He has compassion upon the people because they were like sheep without a shepherd. This gospel reading runs so close to the psalm, it's like a reflection. The two short sections we heard from the gospel didn't include the feeding of the 5,000 that was in the middle. Hendrik would say, that's the Marken sandwich. But in feeding the 5,000, Jesus makes sure that the needs of his people are met. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The people are not left wanting for food. And last week, Rita told us that she never gets stuck. She is a modern need and can be stressful for many. And she felt guided by Jesus. And it reminded me of a Japanese modern psalm that was put on the screen this morning. It's included in the Lion Book of Famous Prayers, together with a black and white picture of pedestrians and traffic. So as rustic, as pastoral as the psalm may sound, it is also for today. The Lord is my pace setter. I shall not rush. I will not fret, for his presence is here. And I have to admit, the first time I used that version, about 30 years ago, I did get some flack. Jesus and his disciples had that psalm in their songbook, not the Japanese one, but the one that Graham sang for us. They, like us, would be seeking calm and assurance that God was with them. They would fear no evil. God's rod and staff would give them all strength and resources needed for challenges. And finally, I wanted to look at the challenges Jesus faced. He was constantly meeting challenges. The people who came to him, as we heard in the reading, they wanted to reach out, the one to heal them, to connect them, to reconnect them, to bring them closer to God, to guide them along the right path in their lives, to be in touch with God's goodness and mercy all the days of their lives. They wanted, as I hope we do this morning, to return to their homes fulfilled in the knowledge that God was with them, and they were worthy to be in his house all the days of their lives. The challenge for Jesus was to meet the needs of his flock, and we are his flock, his people. A flock who just wanted to put their hands on the edge of his cloak, to be in touch with him. And is that not our need too? To be in touch with Jesus each day. As we have prayed our way through this pandemic, and we do not know what dangers lie ahead, let us keep in touch with Jesus. We cannot touch the edge of his cloak, but we can be in tune with his songs that he carried in his heart and mind. We can share the same words and ideas that were on his mind. Psalm 23 is one that we should all take to our COVID-free desert island and say together, "The Lord is my shepherd." Amen.
Thank you, Peter, for that. And so we come to the time of peace. We are all one in Christ Jesus. We belong to him through faith, heirs of the promise of the Spirit of peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. Let us hopefully for the last time offer one another a COVID-safe sign of the peace.
Father God, we give you praise for who you are, what you do. We thank you for your promises are A and Amen. We thank you because you honor every promise you make. And as we come and pray and intercede for our world, our church, our family, and trust ourselves into your hands, thank you because we know that you will speak and perform what you have spoken. In Jesus' name, Amen. Creator of the universe, we pray for our world, that as we rebuild, that you will inspire us to take into account our children's future. Help us identify our differences and embrace our togetherness. Eliminate hate and prejudice and embrace peace. Teach us, Lord, to open our hearts to love and forgiveness. Father God, we pray for our nation. Show us mercy, Lord. Give us skills in our leadership. Direct our ministers. In this time of racial hatred and division, heal our hearts. Help us to see each other as you see us, lovable, admirable, and full of potential. Father, we pray that you will teach us forgiveness and heal our land. Good Shepherd, take control of the affairs of the United Kingdom. Make yourself known in the darkest places. We speak peace and prosperity and healing onto this land. We declare that the UK is the Lord's chosen land and everything in it. Eternal God, we pray for ourselves. Many are suffering from this long hiatus of worship. Many of us are struggling to get back into our routine of spending time with you. And for a few of us, we are just struggling with life as a whole. Father God, help us to take each day as it comes, trusting you and holding your hand. Teach us to lean on you as we stumble in the darkness. Teach us to trust that our God knows the way through the wilderness, and all we have to do is to follow him. And as we prepare for the holidays and the end of COVID, teach us to measure freedom with responsibility. God, we love you. Jesus, we trust you. Holy Spirit, we lean on you. And because you're able to do abundantly, above all that we can ask or even imagine, we give honor and praise to you, our Father, now and forever. Amen. Shall we say the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Sarah's now going to come, as I believe there are some bands to read, and I think quite a lot of notices as we prepare for a slightly different Sunday next week.
You're right, a fair few things to say today, so I apologise in advance. Let's do the bands of marriage first, and we've got three bands of marriage today, and two of them are for September weddings, which are going to happen here. So we've got three weddings booked in for September, so that's really exciting. So, I publish the bands of marriage between Nathan Sebastian Fennell and Bethany Page Dixon, both of this parish, and this is for the second time of asking. And also, Philip Michael Acey and Catherine Prest, both of the parish of Kings Norton, Birmingham, and Timothy Simon Preston and Jessica Alice Russell, both of the parish of Moulton, and those two are for the first time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it. Fantastic. Let's pray for these three couples. Lord, the source of all true love, we pray for Nathan and Bethany, Philip and Catherine, Timothy and Jessica. Grant to them joy of heart, seriousness of mind, and reverence of spirit as they prepare to enter into the oneness of marriage, that they may be strengthened and guided by you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, so as it's already been heavily alluded to, there's a lot changing from tomorrow. And I'm going to talk about some of the really key things, but it will also come out in the email. So please don't think, I don't know if you like me, I'm a bit of a rule follower. I think it's been a teacher. We like rules. I'm a bit of a rule follower. If there's a bit too much to think about here, it will all be coming out in that email, so you'll be able to refer back to it. So, as I said last week, I think it's so important that our church is a place that is safe and welcoming for everybody. And we know, even just from talking as a PCC, we know that different people are feeling really very differently about how things are changing over the next few days. As we return, some people are going to be really excited that we're kind of returning back to normality, and others are still going to be particularly apprehensive. And when you look at the way the cases are rising, you know, you can see both sides of that. The Church of England sent us some guidance on Friday night, and it's a long, a very long piece of guidance, and Neil and I have been digesting it with a bit of help from David. But one of the things I just wanted to read to you is they said, within the church, we believe that everyone is known and loved individually by God, and that as many members within one body, we are called to be responsible to and for one another, respecting the more vulnerable whose suffering is our suffering. And then they say, the move to step four means we are being asked to take even more personal responsibility around coronavirus than when we were compelled to adhere to government restrictions. So, how will things look on the ground at St. Peter's? So, there is no need to book for the services from next week. And I do think it's worth just taking a little minute to thank Julie and Steve particularly for everything that they have done. It has been, bless them, you know, the fact we've all just been able to phone them up, email, they've been here every week setting things out to make sure that we're all safe. So I've never been so grateful to tell anyone they're not needed to do a job in church, but thank you, Julie, thank you, Steve, we're so appreciative. So from next week, we are all allowed to sing. I know it's been very long waited for, hasn't it? Masks. There's going to be no law requiring that people wear masks in church. You may well choose to do so, and lots of people will. You're welcome to wear them just as you come in and out. You're welcome to wear them for the whole service. You'll have seen all the things in the news about people recommending that they're worn when you're close to the people. So it's personal preference. Seating. We are going to have an option of socially distanced seating. Again, it's about trying to make sure everyone feels comfortable to be here. So if you feel that you would like to maintain 2 meter social distancing, the sides of the church are going to be left just for individuals, couples, small groups. No one will join you over there. We're also going to keep the rows 2 meters apart this way. kind of relieves things a little bit. The back couple of rows we will keep as socially distanced as well, because they're better for the hearing aid loop. So if you want to remain socially distanced but you use a hearing aid, you're better to be in the back couple of rows. Just let us know. If people feel particularly anxious about that and want us to really reserve seats for them, just email or phone Neil and I, and we'll make sure that happens. Similarly, leaving the church, if you're anxious and you about leaving and maybe getting close to other people, the doors will be open most of the time, but leave during the final hymn, or equally stay seated and let other people leave, and then you'll be able to kind of go and maintain that distance. What else do I have to tell you? Refreshments. We're hoping to have refreshments starting back up again after our service, and we're going to just wait a couple more weeks just to see how it all works. But we're thinking refreshments will be served from the 15th of August. If you are available to help once a month, once every 2 months, let Rita, Fiona or myself know, because we need to get that rota filled back up again. Sharing the peace. We couldn't really work out how to do it sensibly, safely, making sure that everyone had their own way of how close they wanted to get to other people. So we've decided for the next few weeks, we're going to more or less keep it the same. People can stand up, turn round, wave. If you're sat next to someone that you know wants, that's absolutely fine. But we're not going to be moving around, touching everybody, just because some people, that may well make them anxious. So we're keeping it more or less the same. Communion won't be happening till the first Sunday in August, so we'll give you more information about that before then. Other things we're going to do, we'll still have the hand sanitizer around the church, and we'd encourage you to use it. We'll keep the doors open for ventilation whenever possible, and we will be maintaining the one-way system, come in that door, out at the back, again, just to keep the flow of things. There's a lot to digest there. It will come out in the email. Just a couple of other things. Questionnaires, I know I handed them out last week. I've put some more on your chairs and they're also at the back. Thank you to those people who've returned them. It's so exciting to think about some of the possibilities and some of the dreams we can have about new things that we can start doing, but we need to know what your gifts are, what time you can offer. So please fill those out, pray over them, pop them in the back, pick one up, take it home, bring it back next week. Thank you. What else did I have to say? Oh, don't get excited. Vacancy, we don't have any news. I just wanted to tell you, we don't have any news. We're really hoping it'll be soon. Please continue to pray. And as soon as we have news, obviously, as soon as we can tell you anything, we will. And finally, a bit of advance notice. We're going to have an end of summer picnic. And we've plonked for the date of the 12th of September. More details are to follow. It's going to be relatively simple, but won't it be nice to spend some time together? So it'll be after the service on Sunday the 12th of September, but we wanted to tell you now so that people can get it in their diaries. Thank you ever so much.
And after all those notices, do we have any birthdays or big celebrations? We do. Is it your birthday, Paul? Graham, Steve, can we do the honours, please?
Who are we singing birthday?
To Paul. And for anyone else who does have a celebration to come, we wish you a very happy day. Now may the Lord of peace himself give us peace at all times and in every way. The Lord be with us all, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon us all and those whom we love this day and forevermore. Amen. We prepare to start a new week. I'd like us to finish with a reminder that wherever we go this week, whatever we do, we go knowing we are not alone. We say together the words in yellow. We are many, God's great diversity, yet we are one in Christ. Different faces, different races, yet we are one in Christ. Butchers, bakers, website makers, bankers, tailors, teachers, sailors, yet we are one in Christ. Fathers, mothers, sisters, brothers, single, married, broken, carried, yet we are one in Christ. The happy, the clappy, the barely out of nappies, the ancient, the modern, the famous, the forgotten, yet we are one in Christ. Some hopeful, some hopeless. Some cope well, some cope less. Some sure and some doubt. Some whisper, some shout. Yet we are one in Christ. Those with abundance, those with need, those who are generous or wrestle with greed. Yet we are one in Christ. Elbows, tummies, knees and noses, kidneys, femurs, teeth and toes, some unmentionable, some protected, some accepted, some rejected. Yet we are one in Christ. A broken body torn apart mars God's image, breaks God's heart. And yet our Father knows how the end will be, when all his children will sing in harmony. The bride will dazzle, her branches bloom. So add your voice to hymn the tune that we are one in Christ. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
Oh,